prayer tonight. Come and fill me. Come and fill me.
in your hurting, in your sorrow, I will ask my God to move. I speak the name, 'cause it's all that I can do. In desperation, I'll seek heaven and pray this for you. I pray for your healing, the circumstances would change. I pray that the fear inside would flee in Jesus' name. I pray that a breakthrough would happen today. I pray miracles over your life in Jesus' name, in Jesus' name.
Testing 3-4. Welcome everyone. If you could make your way, we're not going to start immediately, but I know there's some folks still trying to make their way in, and there are lots of seats right here at the front. So if you can make your way in, that'd be wonderful. We'll start in about 2 minutes. Welcome. So welcome, everyone. I know folks are still trying to make their way in. If you are in a row and there just happens to be one seat between you and whoever's next to you, just for the sake of folks who are trying to come in, teachers come in from classes, if we could just make those ends available, it just makes it so much easier for everyone to be a part of the gathering. We do have overflow seating if we need it, but I think based on where we are right now, we can probably all fit in the same room. So welcome. Maybe we should take one more moment and just allow everybody else to come on in. I'm not trying to embarrass anybody, but I don't want to start while folks are still standing outside. So welcome this afternoon. It's a great privilege to be a part of this service and to welcome you to this moment, this celebration of the life of our former head of school, Mr. Steinkamp. To those of you that are younger, Carl. For those of us who are a little bit older, we are live streaming. For those who don't know who I am, my name is Bob Wright, and I'm the high school spiritual life director. And we wanted to take this moment just to honor the memory and the life of Carl Steinkamp. And so you're here because he touched your life. You're here because you knew him in some way. And because this is a celebration of life, I need to say that it's going to be emotional. You may laugh when people tell a story that brings back a memory, and that's fine. You may cry in a moment when you just miss something, and that also is fine. All emotions are welcome because they're indicators, really what's going on in our heart and of the love that we have for someone. For those of you that are online, well, let me start with those of you that are in the room. We have a QR code. And this QR code really is your way of being able to connect with Jackie and with the family. If you scan that, it will take you to our Kudo board, which is a place where you can post a picture, share a memory, just encourage them in some way. So please do that. As well, underneath it, you'll find some links where you can donate to support Jackie and the family or donate to support one of the memorial fund that we're raising for him as well. If you're online, those same codes are just beneath the screen that you're looking at. Now, what Carl really wanted for us to do was to celebrate his life. He didn't want us to grieve. He wanted nothing sad. He wanted balloons. He wanted purple. He wanted it bright. And I know that there's no way to stop some of the grieving, but one of the hopes that he really had was that we would know that God did not fail us at all. And that instead of turning our lives inward, we should instead in this moment turn our hearts up in praise to God because we have a great hope. Jesus said, I am the resurrection and the life. And so we are gathered here to celebrate what God has done in and through Carl and to celebrate the fact that he has been glorified through his life. And so today we're going to sing. Uncle Keith is going to come with a band, and they're going to lead us in worship. And I'm going to encourage you to stand and to be a part of that and to simply use this moment to reflect on the goodness of God in all of our lives. Let me begin with a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, thank you for Carl and for Jackie and for their influence on our lives. Thank you for the way that you use people to shape us and to cause us to become more like you. And Lord, in this celebration together, we pray that you'll be glorified completely in Jesus' name. Amen.
You know, when we think or encounter the grace of God, I feel like the thing that comes to my mind always is that it's amazing. So why don't we stand together this afternoon and sing about that amazing grace, yeah? Who breaks the power?
Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger? King above all kings, who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder, who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder, the King of glory, the King above all kings.
Come on, let's sing this out.
This is amazing grace,
yeah.
This is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross, you would lay down your life, that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
Chaos.
Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King of glory, who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You would lay down your life. That I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
Let's sing, worthy is the Lamb.
Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. Oh, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross, you would lay down your life, that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
Sing the splendor.
The splendor of a king, clothed in majesty. Let all the earth rejoice. Let all the earth rejoice.
He wraps himself.
He wraps himself in light. And darkness tries to hide. It trembles at his voice. It trembles at his voice. How great is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God. And all will see how great.
age to age.
In age to age he stands, and time is in his hands. Beginning and the end, beginning and the end. The Godhead three in one, Father, Spirit, Son, the Lion and the Lamb, the Lion and the Lamb. How great is our God.
Your voice again, sing that. How great!
How great is our God! Sing with me, how great is our God, and all will see how great is our God.
Our God is greater, our God is stronger, 'cause you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power,
our God is greater. Our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God
sings my soul's my Savior God to thee. How great thou art.
This is actually not the first time that I've gotten up on stage and said nice things about Carl for an audience. In 2011, my senior class chose Carl, one of our sponsors, as our commencement speaker, and I had the privilege of introducing him at that service. Although the reason for this service today is heavy with grief, I'm also grateful for the chance to play a part in celebrating who Carl was for our school community and in my own life. My family's story with Carl started a long time ago when he and my dad became roommates for their senior year of high school here at DeLotte, and was strengthened again when my family joined the Steinkamps here at DeLotte in 2001. But my relationship with Carl began personally when I was in high school. In the 15 years since then, I've had the chance to witness up close so many of the amazing qualities that Carl embodied. His faithful walk with Jesus, his deep love for his family, his passion for DeLotte sports and activities, his cheeky personality, and his genuine care for the wide community of people who relied on his leadership. My senior year was my first real insight into Carl as a mentor as I served on our class XCOM as secretary, and the Steinkamps were our sponsors. Carl had a gift for calling out the best in us as we worked to serve our class and the wider school community that year. In XCOM meetings, the person I most often had to get back on track with the agenda was Carl, because he would get distracted dreaming about what we could do and joking around with us and just being fully present with us in the moment. He really loved to work alongside us, scooping ice cream for parties with elementary kids and planting jokes into the script for the after JSB dinner. He just made everything we did really fun. This balance between work and fun was something that continued to characterize our relationship as I grew up too. The summer before my senior year of college, he suggested that I apply for an opening he knew was coming up at DeLotte to teach grades 7 and 8 English. When I came home to Penang for Christmas that year, after I'd done my student teaching and completed the lengthy application process to work here at DeLotte, I did my interviews in person with Shauna, the middle school principal at the time, and then with Carl on the last staff work day of this semester, something like December 18th. When I didn't hear back from them right away, I figured I'd have to wait until January for them to come back to work and make a decision. But Carl had decided right away to offer me the position and had given my parents a special gift to put under the tree for me on Christmas morning. I was totally shocked to open that box with a printed out job contract. I think he'd probably expected me to hand it over at our Christmas party that evening, but I got him back stress-wise by waiting a week of my own to give it to him, signed, of course. His confidence to hire me before I'd even finished college gave me the gift of experiencing life at DeLotte as an adult, too. In 2017, Carl came to me and asked me to sponsor the class of 2019 with him and Jackie. I knew how much I'd loved having them as my own sponsors and said yes immediately. The 2 years of working with them and that class were some of my best years here at DeLotte. Even though Carl held the busiest position here as head of school, he dedicated himself wholeheartedly to making junior and senior year for students both productive and memorable, just like he'd done for my class. Carl had an encyclopedic knowledge of all things junior, senior year and had done all the events a million times, but he was still totally engaged in the process of letting students troubleshoot and figure things out. There was never a problem that could not be solved in Carl's mind, and there was never a task too small for him to do, whether it was grilling burgers for concessions or picking up more paint for the decorations committee, or emceeing the junior for hire, or detailing the run of show of JSB down to the minute. We were the two sponsors in charge of the entertainment committee for JSB, and somehow he talked our whole committee into starting our Saturday workdays at 8:30 every week to maximize our time, even though every other committee came in at like 10. I think he bribed the kids with roti, which helped. He was just so enthusiastic about our work that he got kids to get on board, and they just really loved to do good work for him. His good humor resulted in him always being at the center of class activities. I don't know how any other head of school could have more selfies with their students. All last year, when I was a junior class sponsor, my first time through the junior-senior class experience without Carl and Jackie, I just kept thinking about what they would do in every scenario. After we had the class meeting in November to pick the JSB theme, I texted Jackie this. I'm grateful again that I've sponsored with you guys. I led the whole thing as much like how Carl led those meetings as I could remember. I basically just try to copy you guys as much as I can. And it's true. If you need a roadmap of how to be a person of influence on this campus, you can just look to Carl's life. He engaged in everything he asked his staff to do. enthusiastically teaching classes. Anyone who's taken his media lit class will always remember his rant against milk. Sponsoring over and over again, coaching everything from varsity to D-League teams, being on all kinds of committees, doing Boy Scouts, attending games and concerts and performances, and coming away with specific affirmations for all the people involved. Staying connected to alumni, leading us through many years of COVID with unceasing optimism and grace, far more optimism than I often felt the situation warranted. Caring for colleagues personally and professionally, always being accessible to us despite the load of leadership he carried. He handed out every diploma of the last who knows how many years and graciously accepted whatever prank gift every person in the class bestowed upon him, balloons or reading glasses or ties or playing cards. He was this school's biggest cheerleader, and not just because it was his job institutionally. He genuinely loved us as staff. He genuinely loved our students, and he was willing to take on any role necessary to support the people that he loved. Although Carl filled lots of admirable roles here at school, the biggest piece of my sadness over Carl's death is personal. It's hard to express how much it feels like Carl and Jackie are my family. It was very weird for me to stop calling them aunt and uncle when I started working here. And I only stopped because they told me I had to, because it made them feel old. We've spent so many holidays together. We went to movies together. We vacationed together. Like a good uncle, Carl was so excited when Brennan and I told him that we were dating. He spray-painted bottles for my wedding shower decorations. The evening before our wedding was spent at our venue with Carl and Jackie and my parents. Unloading supplies for the next day. Sorry. He was so committed to making our wedding a well-documented affair that he filmed and posted videos all day long to keep our families updated on the whole event because they couldn't be here with us because of COVID. Our wedding would not have been the same without Carl and Jackie's helpful caring work behind the scenes to pull it all off. Carl was a great uncle, and I'm grateful to have been born into a family connected to his. It's easy to feel overwhelmed with sadness at the loss of such a great man. But Carl's belief in the work of Dilat has actually made it easier for me to stay invested in the days and weeks since his passing. We got the news of his death on a Thursday. And the very next day, my soccer team left for games in KL. On the one hand, I couldn't fathom how anything could be more important than feeling the grief of his death. Soccer games seemed pretty trivial to me. But on the other hand, I thought of all the times I'd seen Carl head over to the gym for basketball practice, still fully dressed in his work clothes to coach whatever team he'd committed to that year. I know that he would have been delighted that we beat ISKL that Friday afternoon. He loved it when our teams did well. And as a Dilat alum himself, he knew the satisfaction of beating a long-standing rival. Carl gave almost his whole adult life to this school. His legacy will always be here, in our campus, in our students, in us as staff, in the memories alumni carry with them around the world, and in the community that sits here today. I'm really grateful to be a part of that community. I'm grateful that Carl's life and mine overlapped in so many wonderful ways, and that our families will always be a part of each other's lives. I hope that we can continue to honor his legacy by doing things with excellence and love and joy, which is exactly what he modeled for us so well.
Good evening, everyone. Thank you for joining me to celebrate the life of my dear friend, boss, and co-worker, Carl. Let me start with my daughter's Esther short tribute. Carl never failed on his students and team he coached, but especially to me. He inspired me to lead with humility and grace. He wrote this Bible verse in my senior tribute, Micah 6:8. And what does the Lord require of you? To act justly and to love mercy and to walk humbly with your God. Carl truly embodied this verse, so I hope his legacy of perseverance and love for the Lord continues to impact people's life, how he was to me. Here are my tribute. All of us has here admired Carl's devotion to the Dalit community and his family. I started working with Carl in year 2007 for the last 15 years. If I was to share everything I appreciated about him, then you all have to stay till midnight. My fond memory of Carl is that he is funny, jovial, humble, servant leadership, had never give up attitude, and go on and on. I'm sure you all know some of them. I remember specifically one time he asked me to prepare a special meal for a staff meeting. He says, can we have salad bar? I say, sure. Then he goes on to ask, cereal bar, potato bar, coffee bar, bread bar. I say, hey, is there any other bars? He always requested nice snack for the staff. And when I say no, his answer is, I will do it. Because of this, I've grown to have a never give up attitude, but to honor what is needed to be done. I owe him for encouraging me to be selfless and pushing me to a different level of serving. During MCO, he requested me to deliver goodies to the staff houses. A few staff helped to deliver as well, but he always volunteered to deliver goodies to staff who live past Fettes Park, even till Green Lane. I say, the police is around. He said, no, I'm not afraid. Okay. He always said nothing was more important than staff, and was certainly true. That legacy that Carl left behind and for his staff admire and love him dearly. Another time, he asked me to cater Mediterranean food for the staff. I told him, the food comes in big pots and we must wash up after the meal. He said, it's fine, I will do it. That night, it was late after the meal, down at the old cafeteria, he washed up all the pots and helped to carry them up the staircase for the caterer to collect them. Carl was a model of servant leadership. You will see him picking rubbish by walking through campus when he sees them. He will make sure the sprinklers are being moved so that the grass is being watered. So I hope that students that are here, parents that are here, can help to pick up rubbish too and help to move the sprinkler so the legacy of Carl will go on. I live on the 8th floor and Carl live on the 18th floor in the same housing complex. I will always remember during COVID, he went to work every day without fear at 7:30 in the morning. At that time, I was walking out. He was on his bike and waved goodbye to me. Imagine the boss going to work, but the staff can enjoy walking in the nearby neighborhood. Since we are neighbors, occasionally on Saturday, I ran into him from the wet market, getting a bunch of flowers and groceries. He's such a caring husband to Jackie. Jackie, he loves you dearly. Remember that. One last final note. The year before he left, he took me to his office and asked me to promise him something. That is to stay and help Shauna after he left. Well, I'm still here, keeping true to his promise. I know we'll all remember him, even though he's no longer with us. I didn't think the last time we met up this July that the goodbyes we said when we parted after dinner, that night will be the last one we've ever said. Lastly, in closing, I have this Malay idiom in remembrance of Carl. Harimau mati meninggal belang, manusia mati meninggalkan nama. literally translated as, when a tiger dies, it leaves its stripe. But when a person passes, they leave their names. Carl has left a mark, a legacy in all our heart. Thank you.
Psalms 46. God is our refuge and strength, an ever-present help in trouble. Therefore we will not fear, though the earth gives way, and the mountains fall into the heart of the sea, though its waters roar and foam, and the mountains quake with their surging. There is a river whose streams make glad the city of God, the holy place where the Most High dwells. God is within her. She will not fall. God will help her at break of day. Nations are in uproar. Kingdoms fall. He lifts his voice. The earth melts. The Lord Almighty is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress. Come and see the works of the Lord, the desolations he has brought on the earth. He makes war cease to the end of the earth. He breaks the bow and shatters the spear. Be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the nations. I will be exalted on the earth. The Lord Almighty is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress.
At the beginning of my senior year here at DeLotte, Carl and Brian showed up as new students. From the first moment I met them, I knew right away that they would infuse our tiny class with loads of life, energy, and crazy fun. While their wild shenanigans sometimes stepped a little bit too close to the line of naughtiness for my comfort level, they sure entertained us all. I'm not sure our dorm parents or teachers would ever have guessed that they would both end up in leadership at DeLotte together. Thankfully, one of our favorite teachers became the school director. Looking past youthful mischief, he hired us all to return as staff. So we owe a lot to Dwight Carlblum. In the almost four decades since I met Carl, our lives became beautifully intertwined with Carl and Jackie's as we shared life together in this place that we love so much. We all worked hard to serve the new generation of DeLotte students and created wonderful memories along the way. As Bethany mentioned, we were together as families, enjoying vacations together in Perhentian and Pancor. We celebrated Christmases every year at our house, and ushered in New Year's at their home. And we shared the joys and challenges of parenthood, watching our little ones grow up into adults. With this rich history, you can understand why the impact of Carl's friendship on us could never be distilled into just a few words. Nor could I describe how much we will miss him. So instead, I would like to share one thing that marked Carl's life from the very first day I met him. His desire to live life to the fullest. Carl poured boundless energy into every endeavor, whether it was performing an interpretive dance for a silly competition when we were kids, or pulling off the best JSB ever over and over and over again as class sponsor. As a teacher, he dedicated himself to creating the most interactive and innovative lessons to give his students the best learning experience. On the basketball court, he inspired maximum effort from the athletes he coached. He loved to win, but even more, he cared about the character of his players. Even during beach volleyball matches on our family vacations, he balanced his very competitive spirit with his desire to bring out the very best in all the kids that were playing with him, and that made it so much fun. As leader of our school, Carl's humility guided him to seek advice and collaborate with others because he understood the collective wisdom of the group usually led to the best decisions. He carefully took time to seek solutions that considered the long-term success of our school and the best interests of everyone who was affected by his decisions. Even though he carried a very heavy sense of responsibility as head of school, he could easily transition from tough meetings to events like all school food and fun fairs or class meetings, to which he brought contagious enthusiasm and such a fun, carefree spirit. Whatever the occasion, fun or serious, light or heavy, Carl brought his very best. In the last several years of serving at DeLotte together, when all of our kids were grown up, the four of us would spend Friday nights together whenever we were both free. During long, long late night conversations, Carl let his guard down and he spoke honestly, as trusted friends can do behind closed doors. In those private moments, we saw the same Carl that you observe publicly. Even when sharing very tough challenges and painful experiences with close friends, Carl's bottom line was always the same. He remained deeply grateful for the privilege of working at DeLotte. He loved this school and felt honored to lead us. I never heard him complain, despite the long hours and tremendous personal sacrifice. I only saw his relentless commitment to do everything he could to make DeLotte the best place, which helped all of us flourish for 20 plus years and even now. Even more remarkable than how he served during his long tenure at DeLotte is how he responded when diagnosed with stage 4 cancer. Carl's intense will to live each day to the fullest only grew stronger. He didn't want to miss a moment with Jackie, Joe, Cassie, and Michaela. No matter how weak or weary he felt, Carl gave every last bit of his heart and soul to his family, his friends, and his life's work. His passion for education remained so strong that he worked in between chemo treatments every day that he felt well enough to function. He also made the most of every visit with old friends who flocked to see him over the past year. The last time we saw him in July, he had to hold his head up with his hands or lean on a wall to talk with us. But he pushed through his pain and fatigue, determined to make the most of every moment we had together. In his battle with cancer, Carl fought for life with everything he had, while fervently hoping and praying for more time. His motto, "Never ever give up," reflected how he lived his whole life. Even in his very last hours, when his organs were failing, Carl shocked the doctors and nurses, everyone who came into his room, with his sharp alertness and presence of mind, because he wanted to save her every moment. Don't you wonder what makes a person so intense? What pushed him to hold on to every moment for dear life? Why did he fight for life so fiercely rather than taking the easier path of acceptance and comfort in his last days? It was not for himself. It was for others. His family, his friends, his students, his staff. His life purpose and passion was to spend his life, every last ounce, serving others, caring for others, loving others. This driving force motivated Carl to work long days and late nights his whole life. It helped him persevere through the challenges of leading our school through massive change and tremendous growth. And finally, it led him to endure the pain of fighting cancer with every ounce of energy he could muster. His deep love for his family and his unwavering desire to be present for them, to protect and provide for them, drove him to pursue every available treatment option. His relentless desire to impact others for good kept him moving through the hardest days. Tributes are pouring in because he gave his all, his very best, for us, for people all over the world. The impact of his life ripples across the globe in the lives of the people who were blessed enough to meet him. Carl lived life to the fullest, not for himself, but to serve others. We will miss Carl more than we can say, but he left us a precious gift. His example. If Carl could be here today, I think he would say, it's worth it to spend your whole life giving your best to others. He demonstrated through the way he lived that this is the secret to fulfillment and meaning. I think that serving others like he did is the best way to honor Carl's legacy and lead us to the best life that Carl would want for each one of us.
Good afternoon, everybody. Hi, Jackie, Joe, Michaela, Cassie. Thank you so much for coming. This room is full, and it blesses my heart. I look at alumni who've come from afar. I look at school board members and friends of ours from other schools, national staff and students, colleagues of mine, parents. And when I see you today, I think of how our contact was when Carl was here, open houses and orientation meetings, all of life. So I get to share with you, you've heard a lot about his professional career, and it's amazing. But I've known Carl since we were barely out of diapers. And we were getting in trouble together as little kids in Vietnam. We found a bottle of baby powder. They still sell baby powder nowadays. I think it's dangerous or something. But back then, it was just out there for kids to play with, and we played with it big time. We made a huge mess. And we did get into some shenanigans here at school. So while we were here together serving for all these years, Carl, as a social studies teacher, referred to it as détente. I knew information about him. He knew information about me. And now that's lifted. So I can tell you some stories. And I will. And when we were here as roommates our senior year, it was before air conditioning, and it was hot. And so on weekend mornings, we would get up early and visit our swimming pool, which was out at the front of campus, in the quiet of the morning to cool off. And we may or may not have been wearing all of our clothes. I don't know. I can't remember that part. We were both in journalism class, which is a class, ironically, that my daughter now teaches. But we were running into some deadlines, and we had a little bit too much fun during study halls and weekends, and we were behind big time. So in true breakout, sort of prison break sort of mode, we snuck out of our room at night in the dorm. We made pillows and lumped them all up, put the covers on, so if our dorm parents checked, they would see something in the beds. And sure enough, we successfully made it down to the jurn room. We worked very late into the night. We met our deadlines. We thought we were in the clear. But we were dumb, because we talked about it. In the van, as we were going to basketball practice, just sort of as kids do sometimes, forgetting that the driver was an actual human being with ears, and we were bragging about our accomplishment, and we got home, and our dorm mom was waiting for us with her hands on her hips. Bad sign. And we suffered. They room confined us for many weekends, which meant we couldn't leave our room. Well, we weren't supposed to leave our room, but we did. We knew some middle schoolers who had walkie-talkies, and so we borrowed them for a little while, and then one would venture out for, and then we'd, Mrs. Horton's coming. We'd make it back to the room in time. And we were competitive, but in a good way. We pushed each other on to the best that we could. I had a goal of breaking the school record for the mile. And I trained for it and practiced hard. And when I tried, I failed. But guess who was running beside me the very last lap? Pushing me on was my buddy, my roommate, trying to get the best out of me. My style made him nuts because I wouldn't study and I would do okay in school. And he worked his tail off. And he did a little better, but not that much better. I didn't think it paid off all that much. I mean, sorry, teachers, but you can survive in life getting C's. I'm just saying, you can. I got selected to represent our school for Model United Nations because I just winged it in my speech, and Carl worked hard, and he did not get selected. We worked through that. So we would beat each other at certain things. I beat him in that one, but then he was selected to be the basketball captain. He beat me there. I got married first, so I beat him. And then we had kids first. He had more. And then he became my boss. So I say all that to say, I've lost a really good friend. And I'm going to miss him. But when I look back at what we have had the absolute privilege to experience together, and you've heard about it far more eloquently than I could say, it's been good. Jesus has always been the center of our lives and our families. And you've heard about how important this place, this school was to Carl. And that is true. But there are just a few things that were more important to him. His family. Although Jackie might disagree from time to time. But his family and Jesus. So I take heart. He beat me once again. To see Jesus face to face. But I know that he will welcome me and remind me that I came second. That's okay. It'll be good. Thank you for listening. Jackie, we love you so much. Can't wait to see you.
Sorry, I have to follow you guys. Well said. Thank you for sharing those memories. I had the privilege of working with Carl for 10 years here at DeLotte. And when I came, I quickly found out that we are totally opposite from each other in as many ways as possible. But we still worked well together because we always had the same vision. And that is a strong heart, passion, and calling for Christian education. Carl spent his entire career in education and was always most energized when spending time with students. Even as head of school, and you've heard this, he prioritized teaching classes, coaching basketball, sponsoring, being a team leader for the Eagle Games, anything with students. He called that the fun part of his job. That meant that most of his real job had to be done outside of school hours after the students went home. But Carl never considered that to be a sacrifice because he was doing what he loved every day. Carl was actually never one of those people who aspired to be a school leader because he knew it would be less time with the kids, which is what he really loved. But DeLotte needed him in a leadership position, and a number of people convinced him to try it just for a little while. That turned into Carl serving as head of school for 17 years at DeLotte. There were many times during those years when he actually longed to leave leadership and go back into the classroom in a way that the other heads of school here will understand. There are days like that. I can't even count how many times he came to me and said, "Can I just stop being head of school but stay at DeLotte? I just want to be a social studies teacher." Because he just wanted to be with kids all the time. But he stayed serving in that role for all those years because he knew that that was what God had called him to do. Carl, for some reason, liked to start hard conversations by saying, "I'm about to ruin your day." Did he do that to the rest of you, or was this just me? It happened a number of times. Or he would say, "I'm about to change your life." So then I would brace myself for whatever was coming. One of those conversations happened in January of 2020. I had just gotten back from an international trip, and Carl told me that the time was coming for him to leave DeLotte. He hoped to do something else and not be head of school anymore. He had lots of ideas, most of them crazy, but they all included investing in the lives of students through Christian education. Carl was not looking to be head of school anywhere but DeLotte. In fact, he said, "I would never want to be out of school anywhere but DeLotte," because he loved this place so much. But that's exactly the path that God laid out for him. And as always, Carl was obedient to God's leading. Throughout his battle with cancer, one of Carl's major goals was to return to DeLotte as an SCW speaker, talking about how God worked a miracle of healing in his life. He wanted to be that example to all of you students of what God can do in your life. Even though that did not happen exactly as he envisioned, it would be wrong to say that God did not work a miracle in his life. Carl and his family and all of us saw one miracle after another. God's leading to leave DeLotte and move to Minnesota near his family, a complete miracle from God. Carl's optimistic and fighting spirit throughout the cancer treatment, which was noticed by all the medical professionals who worked with him. That was a miracle of God. How many of us would have been able to maintain that positive attitude? Carl's dedication and physical strength to continue leading a school and making an impact for the kingdom of God in the midst of his cancer treatments, that's definitely a miracle from God. Just showing up every day. Most importantly, the legacy Carl leaves us is a gift and a miracle from God. From Carl, we have learned to be optimistic, to have fun, to work hard, to pick up trash, to expand the vision, to move the sprinklers, and to obey God every day. So as we celebrate Carl's life, we are also celebrating God's faithfulness. I want to share a verse from the book of Lamentations. The people were facing insurmountable challenges, and they didn't know where to turn. At this time, it was a time of deep grief and deep mourning for the people. And Jeremiah encouraged the people with these words. It is because of the Lord's great love that we are not consumed, for his compassions never fail. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. So as we go through this deep time of grief and mourning and missing Carl every day, may we also hold on to the hope that the Lord's love for us is great. His compassion never fails, and he is always faithful. Thank you.
So I will be singing Amazing Grace as a tribute to Mr. Steinkamp. If you guys want to, feel free to sing along, or if you guys would like to, please just listen. Amazing Grace, how sweet the sound, save the wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. Was grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear, the hour I first believed. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me. And like a flood, his mercy rained, unending love. Amazing grace. The Lord has promised good to me. His words, my hope secure. He will my shield and portion be, as long as life endure. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy rained, unending love. Amazing grace. The earth shall soon dissolve like snow. The sun forbear to shine. But God who called here below will be forever mine, will be forever mine, will be forever mine.
Caleb, isn't a wonderful truth? The God who called me here below will be forever mine. I know it's been a really powerful time just hearing the stories of Carl, and I'm honored just to be a part of this moment. Thank you to each of you for sharing your memories. And we could take a moment, and there would be memories all over this room of the way that Carl impacted so many lives. I had the privilege to know him for really just a year. He was part of the hiring process for me. But isn't it amazing how one person's life can impact you in just a year? Especially when that person is so personable, so dynamic, one-on-one. And that's really who Carl was. And he and Jackie together were this power couple. When they came together, there was something just magical, wonderful about them. And so just before they left, Carl had this little Jaguar. They talked about his bike, this cool little motorcycle. And I'm a biker, and I needed one. I needed to ride. I was feeling it. And so when he was leaving, I finally pulled him aside, and I said, Carl, any chance that you're parting with, you know, the bike? And he made me an offer that I could not refuse. And I think he really wanted me to have the bike, and we were so grateful. And then Jackie pulled Nancy aside and said, one condition, though. You can have the bike, but every time you get on it, you have to think about us. Nancy said, well, I'll do you one better. Every time we get on the bike, we'll pray for you. It was only a few weeks later we discovered about Carl's diagnosis, and it became such a powerful reminder every time that we got on that bike that we needed to pray for them, and we prayed, and you prayed. And I want you to know that God heard. I want you to know that the sovereign God that we serve heard every prayer, responded to every prayer. Maybe not in the way that we wanted him to, but he responded. And I'm comforted this morning or this afternoon by the words of Jesus in John chapter 14. When Jesus said this to his disciples, do not let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God. Trust also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, I would have told you. I'm going there to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you with me, that you also may be where I am. I love that picture that Jesus gave us, that picture with his vivid imagery of a home being prepared for family to come and visit. And my experience with death, 34 years of pastoring and being with people in their last moments, is exactly that. So many times people have said to me, Jesus has come into the room. Physically, sometimes they felt, but the presence of Jesus, just so real. And they knew that he was there waiting for them, giving them the peace and the confidence that they needed to take their next step. And so when I read that, it just makes me think about that Thursday a little bit differently. I can envision Carl in the room with family gathered around him, feeling the love and the comfort of their presence, when all of a sudden there's a hand that reaches down and touches his shoulder. And he hears a familiar voice that says, it's time now, Carl. Your room's ready. And there's a big alumni gathering, and you're the guest of honor. No doubt since, you know Carl, like I know Carl, right? And no doubt because of the way that he'd been fighting, the way that he'd been battling, trying so hard to be all things that he could be. He no doubt looked up at Jesus and said, really now? Because I can see him saying that. I've seen him do that. And I expect Jesus said, yeah, now. The fight's over. Your race is finished. You won. And knowing Carl, he probably said, well, what about Jackie? Because they never went anywhere alone. And well, they did, but, you know, they were always together. No doubt Jesus said, got her. Got her all looked after every moment. And the kids? Got them all. And then knowing Carl, all the responsibilities of the school that, you know, it's September and there's a lot of things that's got to happen. And then there's people who are depending on me and all of you that are praying for him, all of those things. And I can see Jesus just smiling as he's going through his list saying, got it all handled. They'll all be okay. We will all be okay because God's got us. And then I expect Carl said what you know he said. Not my will, but thine be done. And he did the same thing that he'd done his whole life. He turned and he followed Jesus. Only this time, home. And probably along the way, because this is just the way Carl was, probably along the way he started to feel his oats a little bit. You know, the knees are feeling a little stronger than they used to feel for a long time. And he probably said, any chance at this alumni game? You know, alumni, there's a pickup game. Because that's just the way that he thought. And I can see Jesus smiling and said, good to finally have you home. Good to finally have you with me. Isn't it good to have hope? Isn't it amazing to know that Carl is with the Lord? There's no uncertainty about that. It's what makes this moment so much easier. And if you've never experienced that, certainly, can I tell your friend that today you can. You can know your sins are forgiven. You can know the hope that Jesus came to give us. You can know the peace that passes all understanding. That's what Jesus does for us. And I know if Carl could be here in this moment, it's what he would want me to say to you. You can have the same hope that he had to choose Jesus Christ for all the moments of your life. You know, when Shauna approached me a week or so ago and told me the news, it was on that Thursday, I had a verse that just went through my head. It's not something that I would normally share at a funeral, probably not, because most of the time I was the pastor and it's probably not the sort of thing I should have shared, but this verse just went through my heart. It's in 2 Samuel chapter 3, verse 38, and it's David. It's a moment where King David gets the news that one of his friends, young friends, has just died. And he says this in the King James Version. It's the version I grew up with. He says, know ye not that there's a prince and a great man that has fallen this day in Israel. He stops the procession. He stops everything. There's such a, this great person is gone. And it's like, I don't know what to do other than stop and just say something about how deep that shock, that disappointment, that grief was. There are some people, you know this to be true, there are some people who leave such a void. There are some people whose handprints are so large on our lives, their footprints so big in our worlds that when they step out of them, there's just such a gap. And when I heard those words, Carl's gone, there's an that went through my heart. You know, Carl had such a passion for missionary families. Such a passion for missionary students and the students at the LAT. Such a passion for our community. He and yet now he's gone. There's this great man that was there. He's not praying for us like he used to be. He's not in the space where we were familiar with. He's walked out of that space. And the challenges has been mentioned already. The challenges for us to step into it. The challenge that Carl's life leaves us with is to follow Jesus the same way he did. To find that same passion, that same fervor for God, and to live it out as best we can. And so I want to leave you very quickly with Psalm 3, 1-3. Having been a high school spiritual life director who preaches right before lunch, I know how to go quick. But it leads me to this simple thought. And keep in mind as I read this that the word man in this is intended to be generic. So it's for all of us. But David says this, blessed is a man who does not walk in the counsel of the wicked, or stand in the way of sinners, or sit in the seat of mockers. But his delight is in the law of the Lord, and on his law he meditates day and night. It's like a tree planted by streams of water, which yields its fruit in season and whose leaf does not wither. Whatever he does prospers. And I'm just caught by those words. He is like a tree planted by the streams of water. A person like that is a person who leaves a strong legacy of impact with no distractions. They're solid. They're dependable. They're fruitful. They're seemingly immovable. And the psalmist seems to be answering this question. How can we become that kind of person? How can we be that person in our world? And the answer is threefold and very simply. First, it's by putting God at the center of our lives. That's where it starts. Carl did that amongst us. He lived the way he lived because he loved Jesus. He showed grace the way he showed grace because he'd experienced it from Jesus. He lived with vibrant, passionate life because he'd experienced the power of the Holy Spirit in his own life, that resurrection power that caused him to rise up to life. He was full of life everywhere he went because of Jesus. Put Jesus at the center of your life. Secondly, it comes from watching the influences that are in your heart and your life. And I love those words where he says, he delights in the law of the Lord, and on it he meditates day and night. It's the secret to integrity. It's the secret to a life of impact. Letting God's word in consistently, constantly. Letting it be the primary source of influence in your life. And yet the psalmist knows what you and I know, that there are indeed social media influencers out there. We are too quickly distracted, too quickly influenced. And so he talks to us about the people we walk with, the people we sit with, the people we listen to and stand with. Carl surrounded himself with people who pushed him to excellence, who pushed him to greater character, who pushed him to be faithful and not faithless, to keep high standards of godliness in a world full of compromise. And I know that the world is diverse, and I know that there's a lot of different perspectives about things, and he so modeled grace amongst us, so modeled grace amongst us. But he held on to truth. The conversations I had with him about wrestling through representing righteousness and graciousness in disciplinary encounters only in 1 year. I saw the battle for integrity of his own heart. He sought to surround himself with people who would push him to the highest possible standards. Lastly, it comes from choosing integrity of heart before God. Because ultimately, that's who we all answer to. That's where we end up, where we give an answer for the rest of our lives. And I couldn't get through this message without highlighting that one thing, that one day each and every one of us will stand before God and will give an account of our lives. That's what the Bible says. The decisions we have made, the relationships we have had, and the way we have treated others. And I know, like I said, Carl agonized to make sure that he did things right, that he did things well. Probably not always, because none of us are perfect, but he wrestled to make sure that he reflected the truth that he knew. He did his best. Today he's with the one he lived his whole life to honor. He's heard the words, well done, good and faithful servant. He is home. I'm going to invite the worship team to come back at this time, but I just want to challenge you as we draw this message to a close with three simple questions. The first is, do you know Jesus? Have you invited him into your life? Because if you haven't, it is the most decision you will ever make. It's what gives you hope in the midst of every storm. And if you've prayed a prayer and you've gone through that process of becoming a Christian, can I ask you, is Jesus the center of your life? Because it's one thing to believe in God, and it's another thing to put him at the very center of your heart and your life and allow him to direct every moment, every minute of your life. Lastly, are you ready? Are you ready? Because the Bible says it's appointed unto every one of us for a moment just like this. And we don't know the day or the time or the hour or the moment when that will come. What we're called upon to be is to be ready in every moment. If you are not, you haven't invited Jesus into your life, if you don't know the peace and the joy and the grace he provides, then my invitation to you is to do that now, to welcome him into your heart. Jesus, as we just turn our hearts towards you one more time, Lord, I pray that you will fill this place with your presence. And Lord, if there are those right now who are saying, I need to know this hope, I need to know this Jesus, Lord, I pray that you would strengthen their hearts to reach out to you. You are not far from any one of us. Pray that they'll call on you and have the courage to come and talk with us so that we can help them to know you in a better way. Thank you for the testimony of Carl's life. The testimony of your word. Draw us to yourself, we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. You may stand.
I'm calling on the God of Jacob, whose love endures through generations. I know that you will keep your covenant. I'm calling on the God of Moses, the one who opened up the oceans. I need you now to do the same thing for me. Oh God, my God, I need you. Oh God, my God, I need you now. How I need you now. Oh rock of ages, I'm standing on your faithfulness. I'm calling on the God of Mary, whose favor rests upon the lowly. I know with you all things are possible. I'm calling on the God of David, who made a shepherd boy courageous. I may not face Goliath, but I've got my own giants. Oh God, my God, I need you. Oh God, my God, I need you now. How I need you now. Oh rock of ages, I'm standing on your faithfulness. Your children, then you hear your children now. You are the same God, you are the same God. You answered prayers back then, and you will answer now. You are the same God, you are the same God. You were providing then, you are providing now. You are the same God. You are the same God. You moved in power then. God, move in power now. You are the same God. You are the same God. You were a healer then. You are a healer now. You are the same God. You are the same God. You were a savior then. You are a a Savior now. You are the same God. You are the same God. Oh God, my God, I need you. Oh God, my God, I need you now. How I need you now. Oh rock of ages, I'm standing on your faithfulness.
Oh God, my God, I need you.
Oh God, my God, I need you. Oh God, my God, I need you now. How I need you now. Oh rock of ages, I'm standing on your faithfulness.
Amen. We've prepared some light refreshments outside if you want to take a moment and just connect with one another. Also, a reminder about the QR code. If you want to send some messages to Jackie and the family, please do take advantage of that and let them know how much you love them. Now unto him that's able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask or think, according to the mighty power that worketh in us, unto him be glory in the church by Christ Jesus throughout all ages, world without end. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Jesus, may your peace rest on us. As we leave from this place, may we leave with your joy, your peace, your presence surrounding us. We thank you for that in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you.